How much chicken manure is this?
There's probably 100 tons in here.
That's Lee Richardson. He's a farmer in Willards, Maryland, who raises corn, soybeans, and obviously chickens. You might notice that his chicken houses are empty, though. Richardson had just sent his birds to market, so he was between flocks when we visited. But we were actually there to see the manure. All that chicken excrement left behind could be a valuable asset or a costly nuisance. In either case, the reason boils down to one element: phosphorus. Manure is a great natural fertilizer because it's got what plants crave: nitrogen, potassium, and phosphorus. Chicken manure is particularly rich in phosphorus, actually too rich for Richardson and for many other farmers on the Delmarva Peninsula, so named because it has parts of Delaware, Maryland, and Virginia on it. In 2016, Delmarva was home to 4,700 chicken houses, producing over 4 billion pounds of chicken. That puts a lot of manure and phosphorus really close to the Chesapeake Bay, which is cause for concern. 80% of the bay's phosphorus pollution comes from agriculture. Notably, manure used as fertilizer. When rain washes nutrients from fertilizer into bodies of water, the compounds fuel the growth of algae and bacteria. These algal blooms do all sorts of damage. For example, they can poison the water and deplete its oxygen, choking out aquatic ecosystems. Algal blooms grow all over the world. But let's focus on the Chesapeake, a national treasure according to Executive Order 13508, signed by Barack Obama in 2009. This executive order called on state governments to help clean and protect the Chesapeake by, among other things, reducing its phosphorus content. In June 2015, Maryland rolled out what's known as the Phosphorus Management Tool, or PMT. The PMT are rules limiting how much phosphorus farmers can use based on how much is already in their soil. Roughly 20% of the farmland in Maryland exceeds the PMT's low earth phosphorus threshold, meaning those farmers will have to stop using manure or start using less of it by 2022. For Richardson, the PMT means he needs to scale back or potentially cease his manure usage in 2018. So he's going to have tons of manure he can't use. He could give it away to farms with low levels of phosphorus, but he doesn't sound too excited about that option.
It's going to be costly to transport it, you know, 100, 150 miles. You know, that may be what we're looking at. We won't get anything for it. $0 for us.
And he's got reasons beyond money to want to keep the chicken manure.
The great thing is manure just doesn't contain phosphorus. It's got a lot of minor elements. It's got a lot of nitrogen. That's what we want still.
So if there were some way to extract the phosphorus from manure, Richardson wouldn't have to ship his manure anywhere, and it'd be better for the bay. And the concentrated extracted phosphorus would still be a valuable fertilizer, meaning it could be sold for profit to other parts of the country or world that need it. As you may have guessed, we aren't the first people to put all this together.
So I was in my office one day, I got a phone call kind of out of the blue from a company. They said, we're trying to recover nutrients from poultry litter. And so I said, okay, well, I definitely know phosphorus chemistry, and so let's start talking. And so we started talking, had a couple of ideas, and then we developed what we call the phosphorus extraction and recovery system.
Or
PAIRS.
Just a quick note, you heard Blaney call it poultry litter. That's the manure mixed with the bedding from the chicken houses. We visited Blaney's lab near Baltimore to learn how his team gets the phosphorus out of that litter.
So here we have the raw poultry litter that has been taken from farms.
I like that you can actually see like feathers in there.
Yeah, exactly.
It is definitely poultry litter.
Yes. So what we have to do is we put it through a processor and it grinds it up, and then we put it in a dryer, and then we take that out, we get this.
Okay.
Yes, that was a food processor, which works great for the team's lab scale reactor. To go to the farm, the team needs to scale up their entire process. Blaney believes the group will have that done within the next 5 years. So let's take a look at the phosphorus extracting reactor itself, which is made of three separate chambers. In the first chamber, the team mixes dry chicken litter with water. They carefully measure the amounts of each so they can account for all the mass in their system and monitor how well it's performing. The system mixes the litter and water to form a slurry. Then it pumps that slurry into the second chamber, called the extraction reactor chamber. Here, the system bubbles the slurry with carbon dioxide and adds a touch of hydrochloric acid. This acidifies the slurry, lowering its pH to liberate phosphorus and other elements from the solid manure particles. Next, the team waits for the solids to settle out, which allows them to then pump the phosphorus-rich acidic liquid to the third chamber. Here, sodium hydroxide flows in to raise the pH to basic conditions, allowing phosphorus to mineralize as struvite, or magnesium ammonium phosphate. The team can recover 70 to 80% of the phosphorus from manure as struvite, which can be sold as fertilizer. and the phosphorus is way more concentrated in struvite than in manure, meaning the mineral weighs much less and is much more economical to transport. What's more, the team has also developed a process to get potassium struvite instead of struvite. The two are similar, except potassium struvite swaps in potassium for the nitrogen-containing ammonium. So processing chicken litter gives the team access to potassium, nitrogen, and phosphorus. That's what plants crave. Don't forget either that there's still phosphorus-deficient manure in the reactor. That means farmers can put that manure back on their fields to take advantage of the leftover nutrients without worrying about phosphorus. And the pairs process could work for more than just chicken manure.
Moving forward, I think there's a lot of issues coming out of some of the intensive pig farms as well in terms of both nitrogen and phosphorus issues. We can definitely apply the pairs chemistry to that swine manure.
One of the things that stands out the most when talking to Blaney is that he doesn't see waste as waste. He sees it as a resource that can solve problems.
Right now, most of the world's phosphorus comes from one country, Morocco. And so you can imagine that this is like a big economic liability. This is a big political liability. You know, if Morocco shuts down their phosphorus exports, how is the rest of the world going to grow food?
While developing pairs, Blaney's team paid attention to the cost and design of the system to make sure they were building something farmers would actually want to use, which is not to suggest that farmers are averse to technology. Richardson actually started calling up people to inquire about phosphorus extraction technology years ago when he first read about it in a trade magazine. And now, he's donating manure to Blaney's project to help it along. And sure, he wants this technology to succeed so he can continue using his manure. But the fact that this could help protect the Chesapeake is not lost on him.
We live here, we raise our children here, you know, this kind of situation would be a win-win for us as well as the environment, you know, so we're doing everything we can and hope that science keeps progressing, that we can keep progressing.
One last fun fact about chicken litter. It doesn't stink as bad as you think it would. I mean, it's not great, it's a sort of dank, earthy odor, but when it's just sitting out in the open, it's not terrible. And when the scientists scooped it in the lab, it smelled almost exactly like a chocolate candy. I won't tell you which one, but there are two M's involved. Be sure to subscribe now to stay up to date with chemistry news stories like this one.